Welcome to the 10th lecture of this course. We actually stopped at wave equation in the previous lecture. So we will start with this classical eddy current theory. So this will be the first slide of 10th lecture. So classical eddy current theory, we basically solve diffusion equation. A metallic plate excited by a surface field intensity which is time varying. So here, for example, here this is a what is known as semi-infinite slab conducting plate. So why it is called as semi-infinite? Because it is infinite. So this is z direction, and this is x direction, and coming out of the paper is y direction. So semi slab is infinite is infinite in extent in x and y direction. And it is half infinite in z direction, and then we are actually analyzing the diffusion of currents and eddy currents and diffusion of fields into this metal plate, right. So now here, when I am writing this, now we are this diffusion equation we are actually writing it as d by dt is replaced by j omega. So we are working in phasor with phasors now in frequency domain. So now this, if we consider E as only x directed, because analytical solutions are generally simplified. So, as I have told in one of the first lectures also, when you want to derive some simple expressions and understand the theory, you have to do some approximations. So E is assumed to be only in x direction, right, and it is function of z, right. So only as E into z, when it field diffuses, it changes with z. So then, if that being so, then del square E will just get reduced to del d 2 E x by d z square minus, and then minus j omega mu sigma E x is equal to 0. The solution that will satisfy this is this: E x is equal to E x p. This E x p is the amplitude into e raised to minus gamma z, where gamma is propagation constant, right. Gamma is propagation constant, which is given by alpha plus j beta. Alpha is the attenuation constant and beta is the phase constant, right. So here alpha, if you substitute back into this expression, then you will get alpha as 1 plus j square root of pi f mu sigma. So the theory of these eddy currents is available in many books. So one of such books is mentioned here. Those who are interested to understand little deeper into how this derivation comes, how this formula comes, they can refer any of these such books. So gamma is given by 1 plus j square root of pi f mu sigma. So then, since gamma is alpha plus j beta, alpha and beta are given by square root of pi f mu sigma. So going further, Ex then becomes Exp e raised to minus alpha z, because it was earlier e raised to gamma z, but now gamma is alpha plus j beta. And now when we go into time domain, since beta is representing the phase constant, then the expression becomes Exp e raised to minus alpha z. This represents the attenuation, is it not, exponential decrease, cos of omega t minus beta z. So beta into z will give you the phase, with beta being the phase phase constant, right. And then if you substitute in place of alpha, the expression that we have got from the previous slide, then you get exp e raised to minus z square root of pi f mu sigma cos of omega t minus z square root of pi f mu sigma. So now if you see at z is equal to delta, now here delta is the skin depth here. So that is at z equal to delta is equal to 1 over square root of pi f mu sigma, which is called as skin depth, then the magnitude of Ex will be e raised to minus 1 Exp, because this if z is 1 over square root of pi f mu sigma, then this amplitude will become just Exp e raised to minus 1, right. And then at the surface the magnitude will be just exp, because when z is equal to 0 here, this will become e raised to 0, and then that will reduce to just exp, and here this is normalized with respect to exp. That's why here I am just marking it as 1, right? Okay. So now if you see by this expression e raised to minus 1, as we go inside the this conducting plate, at one depth of penetration, which is called as skin depth, the magnitude becomes e raised to minus 1 of that at the surface. So e raised to minus 1 is 0.368. So it reduces to that. So it is exponential decay, and this is a classical eddy current theory and the corresponding diffusion solution. Now, what is the importance of all this in this in the context of our course? So, for example, here if you calculate the skin depth for various materials that we encounter in electrical machines and equipment, for copper at 50 hertz, if you substitute the parameters pi f at 50 hertz, I am calculating mu is mu 0 into mu r, right? Mu r for copper is 1, copper is diamagnetic material and mu r is very very close to 1, but less than 1, but for practical purposes we can take it as 1. Similarly for aluminum it is 1, right? So 1, and the conductivity of copper at room temperature, we are taking it as 4.7 into 10 raised to 7 Siemens per meter, and then you get 10.3 mm as the skin depth for copper, right? Similarly, at 60 hertz it will be 9.4, because it is inversely proportional to square root of frequency. So as frequency goes up, the skin depth will drop, right? For aluminum, conductivity is 61% of that of copper, right? So the skin depth for aluminum is 13.2 mm at 50 hertz. And then for mild steel, which is a structural element used very commonly in machines and equipment, relative permeability is 100, which is corresponding to saturation case. Why we are considering saturation? Because the skin depth is very small, and if the flux that is impinging is getting concentrated in very small skin depth, so the mild steel material is considered as sort of saturated, and the corresponding saturation permeability is taken. Otherwise, we know generally mild steel, it is a type of steel with predominant iron, the permeability will be somewhere around 1000 in unsaturated case. But for analysis, we take mu r as 100, and the corresponding conductivity of mild steel is taken as 7 into 10 raised to 6, one order less than aluminum and copper. And then the corresponding skin depth for mild steel is 2.69. much smaller than aluminum and copper. And then so thing to note is, typically the mild steel enclosures that we build, the thickness is typically 5 mm 10 mm. You will never find steel mild steel thickness 1 mm 0.5 mm. That will be too thin to be mechanically stable. So when you use mild steel material, almost all the loss will occur in the mild steel, because the thickness or the plate is considerably higher, suppose 10 mm, so it is almost 4 times this. We know that this exponential decay, this is like typically in phi exponential, that is e raised to minus phi, if it is there, it will basically in phi skin depths, this value of field will go almost to 0. Like in circuit we have phi time constants, we get almost final steady state value. Similarly, in case of here, in about phi skin depth, the value you can take it as almost equal to 0. So we actually can say that if you use a mild steel material, almost entire loss will get absorbed in the mild steel, and in order to reduce that loss, then you may have to use some kind of shielding. For example, if you have a mild steel plate in the vicinity of, you know, some source which is producing field, and that field is impinging on this mild steel and causing eddy current losses in that, what you could do is you could shield this mild steel by using aluminum or copper, you know, plate, thin plate of at least, you know, something like if it is copper, it should be at least 5 mm, if it is aluminum, it should be around 10 mm. Why it should be like that, I will tell in the next slide. So, this aluminum or copper will basically shield this mild steel material. So, this is called as electromagnetic shielding, right. So, more about it little later. And you know, the what will happen is this aluminum and copper, the eddy currents induced in this aluminum or copper, they will basically repel the incident field, and the mild steel plate will be shielded from the incident field. So, that is, you know, the practical application of such materials. One may also use non-magnetic stainless steel in some applications. So, non-magnetic stainless steel means, you know, mu r is 1, relative permeability is 1, and conductivity is even lower than the mild steel because it is a high resistance material. So, it is 1.13 into 10 raised to 6. Now, here the skin depth for stainless steel, you can see if you put it in this formula, you will get 67 mm at 50 hertz. Now, this is something important. That means, you know, if you shield some electromagnetic device, say transformer or any other device, you know, you enclose it in stainless steel tank, and that stainless steel tank is not going to have a thickness of 70 mm. Typically, again, the thickness will be some 10 mm, 5 mm, 15 mm. So, the field is going to come out of that, is it not? Because, you know, in 1, 2 or 3 skin depths, the field is not reducing to 0. So, in fact, field will come out of that stainless steel enclosure. So, if suppose, you know, you are required to design an electromagnetically shielded product, wherein, you know, your customer specifies that, you know, no field should be coming out of that device, you cannot use stainless steel, you know, material as enclosure, because the field will come out for the practical thicknesses that are used. So, this is again having lot of practical, you know, significance. So, what I am trying to say is this theory of eddy currents is very important while, you know, designing machines and equipment. Now, we will see before going to the next slide, we will see this slide. Yeah, so this is, you know, slide which shows, you know, this eddy loss as a function of material thickness. Now, you know, it is again these three materials are shown which are commonly used: aluminum, which is representing non-magnetic but highly conducting material; mild steel, it is conducting material but magnetic, whereas aluminum is non-magnetic, is it not? So, it is highly conducting, non-magnetic, conducting. Mild steel is, aluminum is highly conducting and non-magnetic. Mild steel is conducting and magnetic, and stainless steel is high resistance material and non-magnetic. So, you know, all three materials are representing three different types of characteristics. And now you can also see here in this slide the, you know, the variation of loss with respect to plate thickness is considerably, that pattern is considerably different in all these three materials. Now, I am not going to go into details of this, you know, but this has considerable influence in deciding, you know, which type of material to be used, particularly for shielding purposes, right, and what should be the thickness of those materials and all that. For those who are interested further in understanding this theory and application of this theory of eddy current, they can refer the book that is, you know, mentioned here below in this slide, right. So, after seeing that, let us go to the next slide. Okay, so, we will talk now about Poynting vector. another important vector in electromagnetics, and it has good influence on the field computation that we generally do as part of this course or in general. And it is useful for even high frequency electromagnetics when we are considering wave propagation. So now P, pointing vector P, is given by cross product of E and H. Now in the case that we analyze, that conductor and the field diffusing inside the conductor, we assume there E as E only in x direction, is it not? And if we actually use one of the Maxwell's equations, that curl equation, we will easily derive if E is only in x direction and is function of z, is it not? That is more important. E x and it was function of z, is it not? If that is substituted in one of the curl equations, you will easily get H only in y direction. So H will be H y, A y, and the P will become then E cross H will be, you know, simply A x cross A y, so that you will get in P in z direction. And that is what we saw there when E was in x direction, right? E was in x direction, although I did not discuss that, but H was in y direction and that gave power flow in z direction, okay. So basically this z is the diffusion of power into the conductor, right. So going further here, we also need to understand what is known as intrinsic impedance, which is intrinsic impedance of a medium, which is given by, in this case, in general it is E upon H, but here for the considered case of diffusion problem, it will be simply Ex by Hy, because E is in x direction, H is in y direction, right. And then if you use the expression that we have got earlier, and if you refer the standard books on eddy current theory, you can easily see this getting derived. Ex by Hy is square root of j omega mu upon sigma, and then you get then expressions for Ex and Hy as this. This we had already written in the one of the previous slides, and Hy by using this intrinsic impedance formula, Hy you can easily determine as being this. Now H also is, there is an exponential variation, E raised to minus z by delta as E, but there is phase difference between Ex and Hy. When it is a free space, in case of wave propagation problems, for example, a lossless case, Ex and Hy they will be in phase, although they are orthogonal in space, but they will be in time phase. But here then, since this is a lossy case, sigma is there, there is going to be a phase difference between E and H, right. So now Pz is equal to Ex into Hy. So it is, now you can see here, when you multiply both this, the power will be proportional to E raised to minus 2z by delta. So what is this power? This is basically representing eddy current loss in the metallic plate, right. So what it is telling is that although E and H, they are varying with single exponential, E raised to minus z by delta, the power is varying with double exponential negative, right. So you will have at z is equal to delta, you will have power E raised to minus 2 into that of the surface value. And E raised to minus 2 is 0.135, that means almost 86% of the power will be sort of lost in one skin depth, right. So 86% of the power is lost in one skin depth, right. So what it tells us is there is a more rapid variation of power as compared to E and H fields. And that is important. If you want to capture that variation, then we have to use very fine mesh when we actually eventually form next lecture onwards, we are going to see that. So we are going to see finite element theory. So we'll again discuss that point when we solve diffusion problem. So we need to have sufficient number of elements in one skid depth, at least 2 or 3, if you are using linear elements. If you want to use only 1 or 2 finite elements, then you will have to do quadratic approximation, that is second order approximation in finite, when you use finite element formulation. What we saw in the previous slide was basic theory of eddy current, and basically which was, you know, we did find solution to diffusion equation, and based on that we calculated the expression, found out the expression for skin depth and all that. Now we'll go further and find out how do we compute eddy current losses in conductors. Now this is very common in electrical machines and equipment. You have either, you know, conductors of copper or aluminum subjected to alternating field, or you may have field because of currents and leakage field in the windings hitting the structural parts, conducting parts, and causing eddy current. Right? So this is common in static as well as rotating machines. So what we are going to see is we will calculate, we'll find out the basic formula for induced losses in winding, conductors, core laminations, joints, and structural parts. Right? There are 2 common cases of excitation. So first, you know, is like this case wherein the conductor in question is very thick and it is excited on both sides by tangential B0 flux density. So here this is electrically thick conductor, whereas since it is, you know, T is thickness is much greater than skin depth, right. The second case is case of thin conductor when thickness is less than skin depth. Right. So, you know, for thickness greater than skin depth, which is electrically thick conductor, the loss per unit length in x and y direction. Now, remember this is z direction, thickness is in z direction. So, the what you have surface, these 2 surfaces, vertical surfaces, they will be the xy planes. So we are calculating per unit loss per unit length in x and y direction, right. So this T is in z direction. So this formula is given by the formula is this, eddy loss per meter square, because it is per unit length in x and y directions. Now the derivation of this is given in this reference below, given below, right. Those who are interested, they can find out
how this formula is derived.
Similarly, this formula below for electrically thin conductor also, the corresponding derivation is given in this reference. Now here H0 is the magnetic field intensity, which is B0 upon mu0, right, and this is the peak value. Now this is the case of inductance limited eddy current, because the thickness is high and the eddy currents will be induced, because when thickness is small you will have resistance being high, and though that high resistance will limit eddy current. But when thickness is large, resistance is small, but inductance will be more. So that is why the first case, when thickness is more, it is the case of inductance limited eddy current, right. Second case, electrically thin, T is less than skin depth, you have again loss per meter square given by this formula. Of course, here sigma and delta have the usual notations. Sigma is the conductivity and
delta is
the skin depth that we have, you know, already studied.
Delta is
1 over square root of pi mu sigma, right. So, Pe in this case is given by angular frequency square, then B0 square T cube sigma upon 24. But generally, you know, in electrical machines and transformers, you would want eddy loss expression in terms of loss per unit volume, because generally it is easier to calculate the volume of the winding conductor. So that is why you further divide this by T in z direction, because this earlier this formula is per unit length or per unit length in x and y. You further divide by unit for the by the dimension in z direction, and then you will get, you know, that one t will go, and this is the famous formula for AD loss per unit volume, frequency, angular frequency square, B0 square, T square upon 24 times resistivity. So, this is, as I mentioned earlier, here thickness is small, so resistance will be high, and this will be a case of resistance limited eddy current. How do we reduce the eddy current loss? That you can do by subdividing the conductor. So, you can divide, subdivide the conductor, and you know, you can, so you eventually, you know, you reduce the thickness to such value which is possible from the point of your mechanical considerations, because lesser the thickness you make, there could be other design considerations as well, like, you know, mechanical strength and all that. So, as long as that is permitted, you can reduce the thickness, go on reducing the thickness, right? And of course, that conductor with that small thickness should be commercially available, right? So, that is the reason that at very high frequencies, you generally do not have single strip conductor available in very thin dimensions. So, then there you use conductor in the form of foil, a very thin foil of aluminum or copper foil, which is of the, you know, the thickness is quite small, of the order of say, you know, 0.5 mm or 1 mm like that. So, you know, that you can use, or at very high frequency, suppose there is some power electronics application, you know, and you know, your frequency is something like more than 10 kilohertz or up to even 50 kilohertz, then what is known as Leeds wire is used. In that Leeds wire, you have thousands of small strands which are, you know, continuously sort of transposed, right, to reduce the circulating current loss. See, because when you use number of parallel conductors, you are reducing the eddy current loss, but those parallel conductors, if they are not linking the same flux, then there will be circulating current loss between these parallel conductors, because flux and therefore inductance and impedance of these parallel conductors will not get equalized, and there will be circulating currents and corresponding circulating current loss. So, that is the reason that whenever you use large number of, you know, conductors in parallel to reduce the eddy current loss, you have to also transpose them continuously if possible and reduce the circulating current loss also, right. So, we will go further. Now, maybe before going further, let me, you know, tell you these configurations which are practically, you know, possible. Suppose, you know, you take a case of transformer. This is a magnetic circuit window, core window, and you have two windings. And we have seen earlier also there is a leakage field like this. Right? It is the transformer window, this is the LV winding, this is the HV winding. Now, if you actually see this winding, if I sort of zoom this winding. This LV winding. Now, this may be made up of conductors or turns like this. The conductors are stacked in a disc form. This is one disc, this will be another disc, and so on. So many discs are there. Now, if you take now one particular turn or one particular turn of this disc, which is of this form now, and there is this leakage field. Now, you can see this leakage field is incident tangentially on its both parts, both surfaces. So, this is the case what we are actually analyzing. So, when this thickness of this conductor is very small as compared to smaller or even comparable with skin depth, that approximation is good enough. Then you have, you know, this thin conductor case, whereas when this conductor is very thick, for example, in case of what are known as bar windings, wherein winding is made up of very thick conductor, very, you know it is like a bar, they cannot be easily bent also. Then that becomes the case of electrically thick conductor, and then the corresponding this formula has to be used, which is, you know, is that formula for electrically thick conductor. Whereas when this thickness is much smaller or comparable or almost equal to the skin depth, then you know you can use this formula for the thin conductor. So the corresponding theory you can see in this book that is given below. Okay, so we will go to the next. Now you know we have more or less covered many topics in basics of electromagnetics. I wanted you to little bit understand this pointing vector, so that some of the very common doubts that we have can get cleared. Now, for example, let us take a case of transmission line. Now, transmission line, we generally say the power flows through conductor. This is a source and this is a load and this is a transmission line. We generally say that, you know, power flows through this transmission line. But generally, power actually is not carried by the conductor. Power is carried by the surrounding field, right. So, I will, explain you both the cases. The power flows in two directions. So, one is along the line in z direction, where the power is flowing along the z direction from source to load, is it not? But that power is carried by this E and H fields. So, there is a E field vertically down, right, between the two conductors, and the H field is shown by dot and cross because current is flowing in this direction, right. Now, actually, if you take E cross H for this H here, E is vertically down, H is into the plane, P will be in this direction. Up if you go, E basically is vertically up, and it that E may eventually go to the reference like this, it may turn, right. But at this point, E will be normal to the conductor because we have seen earlier E is always normal to the conductor surface. So, at this point at least E will be normal, right. Later on it may turn immediately, but that is okay. So, now E has reversed its direction, but H also has reversed its direction. It is now dot and this is vertical, E is vertically up. Again E cross H, if you apply right hand rule, P will be along the this direction, right. So, here who is carrying the energy and the corresponding power? It is basically the E and E field, which is all in this space here, and all this space E field is there everywhere, is it not? As well as the H field is there. So, this E and H field together and the corresponding cross product is basically carrying the energy. So, the fields carry the energy. Now, you may wonder, then what is this current, what is this current doing? And what is happening inside the conductor, right. So, now let us sort of zoom this conductor, this conductor zoom here. Now, I am taking this E, which is this E? E in the horizontal direction, which is basically due to the voltage drop, is it not? Voltage drop across the conductor because there is a finite conductivity and then there is a corresponding voltage drop. And then there will be corresponding electric field intensity, right. So, that electric field intensity is now in this direction, right. And then you have this current is still in the same direction, and the corresponding you will have cross and dot H fields within the conductor. Earlier we were considering H fields outside the conductor in the vicinity. Here H fields we are considering inside the conductor. So, it will be dot and cross, and now again if you calculate E cross H, you will get for this horizontal component and this dot H field, P will be down, and for this two components P will be up. So, that means these two vertical components of P, they are representing conductor loss because of finite conductivity of the conductor, right. So, basically what we understood here is there are two components of E, one we two sets of components. One set of component we considered vertical because of potential difference between the top conductor and the bottom conductor, and the other E field we considered along the conductor, which basically is representing the voltage drop. And then we clearly understood that the power and the corresponding energy is carried by the fields in the fields in the space surrounding this conductor. So all this space here that is carrying the power from the source to the load. Let us see another example of transformer. Now this is a transformer with LV and HV windings as usual, with currents flowing in dot and cross, and the corresponding leakage field will be as shown here. The leakage field will be like this, right? Now actually, if you zoom this, now this part here, the gap between the two windings and the corresponding leakage field here, the leakage field is vertically up for the dot and cross shown, is it not? So H field is vertically up here in the gap between the LV and HV windings. E is into the paper because here LV is the primary winding, yeah. So E will be into the paper, right? And so will be the, and remember this again, E is not necessarily always is associated with the conductor. By Maxwell's equations, del cross E is equal to minus dabba B by dabba T, there will be curling of E field in the whole space surrounding that dB by dt. So that's why there will be E field not only in the winding space, but it will be also there in the gap between the two windings. Okay. So now, so this E is into the paper and H is vertically up. So now you can see again E cross H, the power flows from LV to HV. What core is responsible is only for electromagnetic induction. So core basically is efficiently inducing voltages in LV and HV winding, because without core also you could have voltage induced in secondary winding, is it not? Only thing, it will not be efficient, right? So what actually is responsible for power flow is both E and H fields. E field we understand because of Faraday's law, del cross is equal to minus dabba V by dabba T. The corresponding H is basically once the current flow starts flowing in the secondary, then only power will be transferred to the secondary, is it not? When secondary is loaded, then only power will be transferred. Moment the secondary is loaded, you have this corresponding leakage field here as shown here, and then the whole space of the windings wherever this leakage field is there crossed with E cross H will result into power flow from primary to secondary. Now we'll see another example of pointing vector, and again here it is capacitor, right? Now this is two capacitor plates, right? And capacitor is charged by some source which is not shown. It's a DC source maybe, okay? And then capacitor plates get charged to plus and minus charges. Now carefully observe, earlier also I told the charges are marked with specific logic. Here you can see the charges are more or less equispaced. At the end they are concentrated because electric field intensity is high at the ends because of sharp corners turning this thing, right? On this side, on the top plate also there will be charges. So we generally show, we have been showing capacitor plate as only thin, and we used to show only charges on one side, but here charges will be on both sides, on the top surface as well as bottom surface. But top surface they will be sparsely placed because you have more coulombic force in the inside of the capacitor, is it not? That is why the charges, positive and negative charges, will be concentrated on the inner surfaces of these two plates, right? So that is why only few charges are shown on these two surfaces, top surface of this and bottom surface of this plate, and there will be E field lines like this also, right? Now actually if you see, when this capacitor is being charged, right? So you have, if you see, generally we say that power, we may tend to say that the power and the energy is flowing into the capacitor like this in the vertical direction. But actually power flows, again you apply E cross H concept. Here, for example, take on this line, outside line, E is vertically down, H is into the paper for this current, right, and the P will be like this. Here, E is at this angle, H is still into the paper, P is like this.
So, energy is being fed into the capacitor through the fields in the whole space.
Now, here E is in the same direction. What is reversing here is H, because H will be dot here, and that is why power direction will be reverse, right. So, I hope this makes the things clear. So, we will go further. So, this is the last slide of our basics of electromagnetics module. So, what we are doing is we are summarizing Maxwell's equations. So, Maxwell's equations here are written in differential as well as integral form, right. So, I do not have to read this, you all know by now all these equations. Also, we time to time we converted those differential form of equations into integral form as listed here, right. Now, one question may come into our mind that what about electromagnetic boundary conditions under time varying fields, because we initially saw boundary conditions for electrostatic fields, then we saw magnetostatic fields. Now, we will see what happens when time varying terms like this d psi by dt or this term dabba d by dabba t term, they come into picture, what happens to the boundary conditions. Now, although we did not derive earlier any of the boundary conditions, for understanding the contribution of this time varying term, I have just derived here for one case, that is we will derive the boundary conditions for tangential components of electric field intensity. Now, if you read any textbook, standard textbook on electromagnetics, they will take a boundary like this with two materials, this is material 2 here and here material 1 with E2 and E1 as the electric field intensities. Now, you take this contour at the interface and that contour you take that such that delta H is very small. So, now here you have this contour and the corresponding area ds is this, and the n vector will be vertically downward, that is into the paper in this case, right. And but since delta H tends to 0, ds also will tend to 0, because one of the of this rectangular sort of contour, if you assume this as rectangle, since delta H tends to 0, the area will tend to 0. So, this contribution of this, because as we have seen earlier, and I told you that boundary conditions are derived by using integral form of equations, is it not? Differential form would not help, because differential form of equations are telling you what is happening at a point in space, but here we need to integrate something along the surface, so you have to use integral form. So, integral form, when we use this integral closed line integral E dot dl is this. Now, here ds will tend to 0. So, that is why
this time derivative term
does not contribute to boundary conditions. So, you get your usual E1t is equal to Et2, which can be easily derived now, because integral E dot dl is equal to 0. The tangential component of E2 is opposite to this delta w as a vector, because the integration you are going taking along this direction, whereas E tangential is along this direction, right. So, that is why you get a minus sign here, E minus E2t delta w, right. So, then you that is why finally you get E1t as E2t right? Just for the sake of completeness, I derived this so that you also understand that the time varying term doesn't contribute in deciding the boundary condition, right? And then using the same concepts, for example, this d1n is equal to d2n can be derived by using, you know, pillow box, right, at the interface, and then, you know, you do the surface integral and all that. You can see any standard textbook on electromagnetics. And remember, this is in absence of surface charges, right? So d1n is equal to d2n. Similarly, you have b1n is equal to b2n, and h1t minus h2t. Previously, you know, when we studied magnetostatic, I equated this to 0, because that time, you know, the surface currents we were not considering, because surface currents will generally come at high frequencies. Now, since we have studied the skin depth and the theory of eddy currents, we now know that as the frequency will increase, right, the skin depth will become smaller and smaller, and in the limit it will tend to be a, you know, surface current. The eddy current will be on the surface only. So in such cases, then it is very much relevant to consider those surface currents by the, you know, k, and in that case h1t will be, h1t minus h2t will be equal to k, right? And k here is the only magnitude, because these h1t and h2t are magnitudes. So I think with this we have completed basics of electromagnetics. So we almost, you know, took 8 hours of half an hour. In about 4 hours, we have roughly 4 hours we have completed basics of electromagnetics. And as you might have noticed, they are not just simple basics as described in any textbook, but everywhere we understood the relevance of whatever theory that was covered in terms of finite element analysis in general. The relevance was there in most of the cases. So I think we are all set now to get into finite element analysis of machines and equipment from the next lecture. Thank you.